Good morning, everyone, and welcome to church today as together we seek to sing God's praise. Let's begin to do so, and with hymn 251, I the Lord of Sea and Sky.
I'm
Let us pray. God, take the road out. Black rock, a viaduct, a waterfall, a paddock, equitation centre, recording studio, dance academy, three schools, the memorial hall, bowling club, tennis club, Masonic hall, restaurant, hotel, and pub. With history too, Lord, John Parker, John Buchanan, Thomas Donohoe, McAdams, Rudolph Hess, with an identity, a sense, and a spirit of belonging, of being part of something identifiable, connected to one another. And so today we pray from one railway station to another, and from Busby to Thornton Hall, from Glen to Garage, from Bystone to Bonneton House, that in all we say and sing and do, we might say and sing and pray and do together and in your name, God, and to your greater glory, help us to be these things. Amen. And the tale today of two Bruces. And the first is Bruce Kent, who died just last month. He was 92. I remember him in the 1980s, listening to him with hundreds of thousands of others in Hyde Park at a rally for Christian CND, well, CND, although I was there, a member, as Bruce himself, when he'd joined CND to be the Christian branch in 1960 as a member of Christian CND with my little metal badge, which I still have to this day pinned on my lapel. I've been interested to read the obituaries of Bruce Kent of the last 3 or 4 weeks. He was born in London in 1929. He served as a soldier from 1947 to 1949, and then studied at Able Bruce Kent, quite quickly becoming secretary to Cardinal John Heenan, who then made him chaplain to University of London, where a number of things happened. He became very ecumenical, working closely with other chaplains from other denominations, but also from other faith groups too. He realized that leadership within the church needn't be exercised by, or solely by, those with dog collars, like himself. He champions the laity within his own denomination. And he took note of what the students were up to and of their activity, particularly around issues of peace and justice. He became chair of the charity War on Want in the 1970s, and it was John Heenan's successor, Cardinal Basil Hume, who permitted Bruce Kent to become General Secretary of CND itself in 1980. which wasn't a terribly significant appointment at the time. CND only had a membership of just over 3,000, but before long, and with the announcements that there would be Trident here north of the border, and that American nuclear weapons would be kept at Greenham Common by the end of 1980, Bruce Kent was finding himself addressing 80,000 people in Trafalgar Square the following year in Hyde Park, and the number seemed to grow year on year. It was 250,000 people who gathered to hear him. In 1967, he'd written an open letter to the Times attacking one of his colleagues, the naval chaplain, for blessing the launch of Polaris. And it was this sort of tension that existed between those within Catholicism who could do such a thing, when his own faith led him to, for example, later on come up to Faslane and exorcise rather than bless Polaris. That by 1987 reached such a head that when he had a word with Cardinal Hume, Cardinal Hume accepted not his resignation, but his retirement. Bruce Kent's hero throughout his life and inspiration was a man called Franz Jägerstätter, an Austrian farmer who in 1943 was executed for refusing to fight in Hitler's army. Bruce Kent weeping when he shared the news with close friends that he was to retire. Over a year later, there was no connection between the two events. Bruce and Valerie Lossetti had been friends. They'd worked together for Pax Christi, a Catholic organization committed to peace and justice for years, but they were now to be married and to be married ever since the end of the Cold War. And you'll remember Glasnost and Perestroika, meaning that the nuclear threat for these past 3 decades, at any rate, up until very recently and earlier this year, has been less potent than it was way back. Then Bruce, though continuing to be active, for example, in his attendance as recently as May this year in Tavistock Place in London, he attended an annual event held there honouring conscientious objectors from all over the world. And last year, he and Valerie and his wife were awarded a Lambeth Medal by Archbishop Justin Welby. And that was for their joint ecumenical work over the years. You know, there's a key moment for Bruce Kent in the journey of faith he took during his lifetime. And that was the 1971 decision by a synod of bishops in Rome that the gospel, it does have a power to set us free as individuals from sin, but it also has a power, they stated, to set people free from what sin does to our society. Bruce Kent, may he rest in peace. Our hymn is 166, Lord of All Hopefulness.
The night is behind. We'll come to the city. second reading is from Luke chapter 10, verses 1 to 11. Jesus sends out the 72. After this, the Lord chose another 72 men and sent them out two by two to go ahead of him to every town and place where he himself was about to go. He said to them, "There is a large harvest, but few workers to gather it in. Pray to the owner of the harvest that he will send out workers to gather in his harvest. Go, I am sending you like lambs among wolves. Don't take a purse or a beggar's bag or shoes. Don't stop to greet anyone on the road. Whenever you go into a house, first say, 'Peace be with this house.' If a peace-loving man lives there, let your greeting of peace remain on him. If not, take back your greeting of peace. Stay in that same house, eating and drinking whatever they offer you, for a worker should be given his pay. Don't move round from one house to another. Whenever you go into a town and are made welcome, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in that town and say to the people there, 'The kingdom of God has come near you.' But whenever you go into a town and are not welcomed, go out in the streets and say, 'Even the dust from your town that sticks to our feet, we wipe off against you. But remember that the kingdom of God has come near you.'" Amen. And may God add rich blessings to these readings from His Holy Word, and to His name be all glory and praise.
Thanks, Susan. The gospel is preached in New Testament times by Jesus and his disciples, the apostles, to individuals, yes, but to whole communities as well. And we see that in our Old Testament lesson for today. It's Jerusalem that is being addressed, and in our New Testament reading as well. It seems there was a practice in Jesus' day amongst pious Jews of symbolically separating themselves from Gentiles as they passed through Gentile towns. They would either shake or wipe the dust from the soles of their feet as they left. And what is happening here with this instruction by Christ to the 70 or the 72 who've been sent out by him to heal and to teach and to tell the gospel is that this practice is being employed, or there's a suggestion that it be used, not by pious Jews against Gentiles, but by certain Jews against fellow Jews. There's no actual record of it having been done, however. Although in Acts we do have in chapter 13 an account that by way of protest, as Paul and his companions left the city of Antioch in Pisidia, on their way to Iconium, they did just this and shook the dust of Antioch from their feet as they left. I suspect that although this was part of Christ's instruction manual to his followers as they went from town to town, that what he was sounding here was more a note of regret than protest at those towns who, and we can well understand dissidents group. We have wary, for example, in the previous chapter that we had last week in Luke, with just the 12 go out and they come to a Samaritan town and aren't received there. And James and John ask Jesus, will we call down fire from heaven on this place? And Christ rebukes them. There's no record of any dust being shaken from feet. I sense that what's happening here is regret, as I say, rather than protest, and that it's the regret that these people don't realize just how close the kingdom of God has come to them and to their lives. This practice smacking to me of superiority rather than the humility Christ preached. To say we can understand a villager, a town, not wishing to harbour those who might be construed as dissidents, lest they attract the unwelcome attention of authorities who may bring violence with them. The point I'd like to make this morning. Just for us and for our personal and individual salvation, but that the gospel, if it's any power at all, it must also have the power to save us from sins inflicted on us as a society. Do you know, there's an excellent example, I think, of this here in the UK, and it can be found in Garstang in Lancashire, which is 10 miles from Lancaster, 10 miles from Preston. I've never been there, but quite like to though, because what happened with its population of around about 5,000 people was that there was a man called Bruce Crowther living there and working there as a vet. He's still there with his wife and three children. And in the 1980s, he was a campaigner for Oxfam, and he decided to found a local group which was quite active within the town. But by the year 2000, they've been connected to the Jubilee 2000 campaign as well. But this little group, led by Bruce, they decided, you know, we sell fair trade products at all sorts of events, galas, returns, church occasions. But what if we made sure that all the businesses were signed up to a pledge to do the same? What sort of message might that send out to the surrounding countryside and indeed the world? And so in that year, Garstang became the first fair trade town in the world. Bruce himself, he was asked by Oxfam to take on a role that was sufficiently time-consuming that he left his practice as a vet. And for a number of years, he worked founding or helping communities to found fair trade villages and towns, cities, whole nations all around the world. He setting up the only, so far as I know, fair trade visitor centre in Garstown, which also has a cafe and a shop, and that's since moved to Lancaster, the priory there. The work continuing in such a way that in 2007, Gordon Brown included Bruce Crowther as one of Britain's everyday heroes in a book of that same name, devoting a chapter to the work he'd done at the Fig Tree, and prior to that, in 2009, Bruce Crowther being recognised royally by being awarded MBE. Since when, and he's been anxious to establish links with growers in countries such as Ghana, for example. And I remember going to the General Assembly one year, and there was a fringe meeting, and it was held by World Mission, and there was a speaker from an African nation, and they were saying that we might think it's fair trade if it's got the fair trade logo on the packet, but what has been happening so often is that people have been using that logo without going to source, but just going to the market to which the farmers bring their produce. Bruce Crowther always anxious to get to the source itself. And he's done that so successfully that he's an honorary sub-chief in a village in Ghana, but he's traveled extensively throughout the developing world. And having worked with farmers in this country, many of whom struggled to pay their vets fees, but many of whom struggled to produce food for more than it cost them to do so at market, he's been able to make a connection with people in similar situations whose margins are extremely small in countries such as Ghana. When he accepted his MBE, Bruce Crowther doing so on behalf, not just of himself, but even just of the team of people he works with in Garstown and now Lancaster, but millions. He said, I'm just one of millions of people who care about the poverty and inequality that underlies most, if not all, that is wrong in our unjust world. I hope by accepting this award on behalf of this mass movement of people, it will help to promote even greater awareness of poverty. The part we all play in it. He's written and not got my hands on a copy yet, but an account of his life's work in a publication called Not In My Lifetime, and that came out just last year. Available through all good bookstores. Amen. Now we're going to sing the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven.
Our Father, who art in heaven.
offering will now be brought forward. And then Pearl's going to lead our prayers for us.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, you have given us riches beyond measure. We can only return a fraction of what we owe you, but we ask, Lord, that you bless our offerings and help us to use them wisely in your service and for your glory. Look kindly and with compassion on this congregation as we seek your blessing on this church. Bring your healing presence among us and help us to feel refreshed and renewed as we worship together this morning. Jesus, light of the world, help us not to fear your light, but to welcome it. Today, as we walk in the shadows, shine your light upon us and banish any darkness from our lives. Lord, enable us to listen. Enable us to make time not only to speak to you in prayer, but to listen to you. And Lord, forgive us. Forgive us when we do not heed what you are saying to us. Forgive us when we lead fruitless lives and fail you. Lord, help us. Help us to be sensitive to the feeling of others. Help us to be thoughtful in our judgments and opinions. And finally, Lord, send your love. Send your love and comfort to those who are troubled or ill or grieving. Send your love and reassurance to those who are lonely or worried or depressed. Send your love and support to those who are apprehensive or sad or afraid. And send your love and protection to those who simply find life a challenge. We can commit them now to your loving care with confidence and trust. Help us to make life simpler, Lord. Enable us to throw out our phobias, tidy up our needs and wants, dust down what is important to us, and simply get on with our lives. When we are at odds with everything and everyone, open our hearts to the power of your love. When we moan about your world, open our eyes to its beauty. When it rains, look for rainbows, and when it's dark, look for stars. But also, Lord, make us feel happy, contented, and fulfilled with life, and with your church and your teaching. Joy is your natural element. You are the wellspring and source of all joy. The flowers and the trees, laughter and song, love and understanding. Strengthen our faith so that we may lay aside our doubts and fears and wholeheartedly embrace the life you would like us to lead. Deepen our faith in you, our Lord and Redeemer. As it says in that old hymn that we sang last week, yield not to temptation. Ask the Saviour to help you, comfort, strengthen and keep you. He is willing to aid you. He will carry you through. And now we come to our final hymn, which I must admit I have forgotten what it is. That's something. It's number 154, How Great Thou Art, and that's because I have left my order of service on the tree and not with me.